Thanks for watching AI Weekly Update from Henry AI Labs. This weekly update will start off with this awesome tutorial on the cutting edge of model-based deep reinforcement learning for robotic systems presented at NeurIPS 2020. This presentation walks us through this progression of going from more diversity and more difficulty with generalizing these model-based robotic systems into handling a more diverse set of tasks from dexterous manipulation to navigation tasks. Then we'll look at what happens when you scale up language models that model amino acids and protein sequences up to a billion parameters. So particularly they've scaled this up to a billion parameter transformer model, and their data set comprises 250 million protein sequences that have 86 billion amino acids in them. In a similar vein as the natural language processing pipeline of pre-trained and fine-tuned, they're gonna fine-tune these transformer protein language models on the structure prediction task that AlphaFold 2 does, and they'll show that the language modeling learns a really great representation for doing this structure learning task. Then we'll look at wilds, a new benchmark of datasets for in-the-wild distribution shifts. This paper talks about the different kinds of distribution shifts like domain generalization or subpopulation shift, and it explores it across seven different data domains that vary enormously from, say, satellite images to molecular graphs or online product reviews. Then we'll look at this new paper from DeepMind that shows that a deep neural network only architecture can outperform neurosymbolic AI methods on this task of reasoning when you have this environment where you have the toy datasets like the Clever dataset or Clever-er dataset, and you're trying to do these reasoning tasks about the interactions of the objects in the video. Then we'll cover this really awesome survey on meta policy gradients, treating the outer loop optimization problem as a reinforcement learning problem and looking at how we can have these second order policy gradients to better learn how to learn. Then we'll look at this paper on semi-supervised reward learning for offline reinforcement learning. When we have this offline reinforcement learning previously collected demonstration data, it's not always densely labeled with respect to the reward that the demonstrator was trying to achieve. So we have to have a way to propagate annotations and create a reward signal for our offline reinforcement learning agents. Then we'll look at this approach from the Stanford AI Lab blog to explore different models like supervised learning, CIFAR-10 classification, or SimCLR, self-supervised learning, to test for different learning algorithms and see what is the best performing or what might be happening in biological brains, exploring the idea of local updates, as in the Hebbian learning idea, compared to the global backpropagation update. Then we'll explore a cool new trick for data augmentation in instance segmentation developed by researchers at Google, UC Berkeley, and Cornell University. They're looking at taking these different instance segmentation masks and copying and pasting them together to form new images and thus have a larger data set to train these instance segmentation models, as in to prevent overfitting and use data augmentation to achieve better models. Then we'll look at this warning from the Google AI Lab blog about training data extraction attacks. What they're showing is that you can rely on the fact that these models are overly confident on the training data they've seen in order to reconstruct that training data. Then we'll look at a generalization of transformer networks to graphs. These transformer networks in natural language processing treat these language sequences as a regular graph, as in each word is connected to every other word. But other graph neural network problems like chemistry or social network graphs, they don't have this regular structure. So they're looking at how they can add different ideas in the transformer architecture to generalize this to graph neural network problems. Finally, we'll conclude with what's offered in Hugging Face's new supporter tier, the new Papers with Code newsletter, and Apple's released HyperSim dataset. There are tons of great tutorials from the NeurIPS 2020 conference posted on Slides Live, but what's a better topic than model-based deep reinforcement learning? So let's dive into this talk from Anusha Nagabandi on model-based deep reinforcement learning for robotic systems. Anusha is a member of the UC Berkeley lab with formerly Chelsea Finn was there, Sergey Levine, Peter Beal, and they have all these great papers where they've done some really amazing work in the reinforcement learning for robotics space. So I highly recommend checking out our Google Scholar page as well and diving into some of these papers. That'll be linked at the bottom of the slides throughout the presentation. She begins the presentation with the quote, "The hard things are easy and the easy things are hard." This is in reference to things like IBM Watson, Deep Blue, or the Boston Dynamics acrobatics, where you see these Boston Dynamics robots that can jump off of the boxes really impressively. And these are the hard things, you'd think, being able to answer these Jeopardy questions, being able to jump and do a backflip. But these are actually easy when you set up this task and then completely optimize for it, kind of the idea of trading the priors and experience for this task-specific skill. But the easy things are hard, and here we're referring to generalization, diversity, performing in a wide range of environments. Not only being able to have the Boston Dynamics robot run on this terrain, but run on any given terrain, on any mountain, field, any kind of surface like that. So this is the idea of generalists versus specialists. And specializing is easy. We define the task and then over-optimize for it. But generalists that can, say, make a cup of coffee in any room of any house, that's really hard to do. She further describes how this diversity emerges in real-world problems. Say you want a robot that can clean your room. First, it has to find a chair to move it. Well, there are many different kinds of chairs that exist in the world. In addition to that, it doesn't know affordances or exactly where to grab on the chair to move it. Should it pick it up? Should it just drag it across the floor, slide it out, and all these kinds of variances that happen when a robot has to be tasked with cleaning a room. So she breaks it into these three topics that are really important for generalization and developing these robotic systems. And these three definitions from two papers and the Merriam-Webster Dictionary serve as a pillar point for models that learn these abstractions and has the model of the world, meta-learning, where we're leveraging our prior experience to solve a new task, and then online adaptation slash inference, where we're suddenly in a new environment. How are we going to adjust quickly so that we can perform well? Having defined these pillar points of learning a model, meta-learning, and online adaptation, she takes you through this 7-part pipeline of how they moved from more diversity and increasing the difficulty of their experiments at this UC Berkeley lab. So she begins by describing the model-based reinforcement learning problem. We have a state action pair, and we want to learn a function that predicts the next state S prime from our state action pair. So typically they've done things like, the motivating example is this roach robot. And the roach robot is interesting compared to like a vision-based system, because it has this input of these different state variables. So there are OpenAI gym environments as well that operate by having this set of, say, the like cosine angle of the joint, hip joint of the bipedal walking agent, things like this. Having this set of, say, numeric continuous valued state variables that you're predicting when you're doing this model-based reinforcement learning of going from state action to next state prime. So it's different from, say, a vision-based model-based reinforcement learning problem, where you're kind of learning like this pixel map transition, like, say, the world models paper from David Ha and Jürgen Schmidhuber. So she talks about how they start off with these piecewise affine functions, simpler functions, and now obviously we get into the hero of our story, deep neural networks and deep learning, to learn these state action to next state transitions. So she describes the model, the pipeline, they have the data, they train the dynamics model, then they predict this controller, and then the controller is the second part of the model-based reinforcement learning system. So as in, say, MuZero, they have the dynamics model, and then they also have a planning agent. So in optimal control theory, these kinds of model-based control algorithms, they use the prediction, the model of state action to next state, to roll out several trajectories within the agent's own imagination, and then from there make a better decision than just the immediate one-step look ahead. So at level 2 of our ladder to more diversity and more difficulty, we saw how we learned this dynamics model from SA to S prime. Now at level 3, we're looking at different terrains that the roach is making a path. I think it's just trying to go from point A to point B, but it's got to walk on different surfaces like carpet and styrofoam. So for one, it's really interesting to see this control in this experiment where they have this data on the model-based transitions on a carpet surface and a styrofoam surface. And you can go through this table to see how it transitions when it's trained on carpet and then asked to generalize on styrofoam. And again, you see this difference. This is the hard things are easy, easy things are hard. It's trained on carpet, and then if you put the same robot on styrofoam, the error basically triples from 5.69 to 18.62. Same story with trained on styrofoam, 8.15 error, and now evaluated on carpet, and then trained on both, you don't see as high performance as if you specialize on either terrain. So this is the idea that a single model can even encompass both of these terrains. So one SA to S prime trained on carpet and styrofoam, without the additional conditioning that you're on a carpet, you're on a styrofoam, it's going to not perform as well as if it was on any single individual domain. And that's, again, this idea of over-specializing to a particular configuration of these problems. So what she describes is in the first paper linked at the bottom of the slide is using image condition dynamics models. So now the roach robot looks at the ground and it classifies it, I'm on styrofoam or I'm on carpet, and then it can just use this kind of like embedding layer filtering to separate out its features and then, you know, gain these benefits that it has from working with a single terrain. So having started the experiments with the roach that's moving from point A to point B, now they're scaling up to dexterous manipulation. This is where the robotic hand has to juggle these yellow and pink balls around such that it's keeping them upright, and I think it's just trying to move them clockwise or counterclockwise, keeping this orientation of one in front of the other. So it requires much more fine-grained control in order to perform this task, similarly to the OpenAI solving the Rubik's Cube with a robotic hand, where you have to have really fine-grained control in order to perform this task. So again, in our theme of scaling up from diversity to difficulty, how do we have a set of diverse environments rather than just say, putting the perfect configuration of having the same weight, shape, and all the same environment parameters for our dexterous manipulation task? So then she starts describing the online adaptation problem and how they can use meta learning to learn an update rule and start doing adaptations to these new configurations of the environment. One of the most popular approaches to meta learning has been the MAML model agnostic meta learning algorithm. In this case, what you're doing is you're trying to learn a good initial set of parameters such that it can learn quickly when deployed in a new environment. So say you have a theta star that learns quickly in the carpet, gravel, turf, and styrofoam environments such that you deploy it in the carpet environment, then theta star gets moved to theta carpet with say like 5 rounds of updates, or the idea is that to keep that round of updates as small as possible. So then she goes on to describe some of the limitations of this kind of approach of having the theta star approach for each of the different environments and some ways around that they've explored. So I highly recommend checking out this talk about model-based reinforcement learning and a set of really interesting experiments that they've run and how far they've come in understanding this model-based reinforcement learning problem in the perspective of model, meta-learning, and online adaptation. In this weekly update, we have some really exciting news from a group of researchers at Facebook, Harvard, NYU, Chicago, Yale, that have put together a protein language model. So right off the bat, they have 250 million protein sequences that are supposed to represent evolutionary diversity, meaning that they've been naturally filtered out in the space of this combinatorial explosion of potential protein sequences. So there's some filtering that, kind of like in the same way that you would say the Wikipedia corpus is a curation of natural language and the combinations of natural language tokens. So across these 250 million protein sequences, there is 86 billion amino acids. And so these are just these sequences of the 21 amino acids chained together that form the protein. So what they're doing is they're training these language models on these sequences. And as a result, the representations are able to perform these downstream tasks, like say what AlphaFold 2 does with structure prediction. So you can train these language models, then fine tune the language model, or the, let's call it amino acid model maybe, or just self-supervised generative model. You can either do the autoencoder style like BERT, or you could do the autoregressive style like GPT. But either way, we're training these self-supervised generative models on these amino acid sequences, and then they're fine-tuned for different tasks. So one interesting thing they talk about in this paper also is the evaluation of self-supervised representations. In this case, they're looking at the TSNE clusters of proteins that are evolutionarily related to each other and how they cluster in this embedding space based on the representations learned from language modeling. And then here's another paper they did that is about taking apart the different hyperparameters in a similar way as the Roberta paper looks at different factors that you can put into training these language models. The most common way to evaluate generalization of a machine learning or deep learning model is to hold out a test set of data and then train our model on the training set and then report the test accuracy, ROC score, whatever we're doing with this held out test set. So this train test evaluation is what's most commonly done to claim that a model has achieved generalization in its training. But really what happens is we deploy these models into the real world and some kind of data distribution shift happens where this data in the test set is sampled from a different distribution than our training set. So we want to have better benchmarks, better ways of trying to account for this distribution shift and report a proper evaluation of whether our model will be able to react accordingly when we have distribution shift in the wild. In this paper, Wilds, a benchmark of in-the-wild distribution shifts, these authors collect a set of examples of real-world distribution shift. So the first thing you may notice about this benchmark is the diversity of these applications and data domains. We go from satellite images to camera trap photos, tissue slides, molecular graphs, product reviews, and online comments. So it's a very diverse set of data domains that are collected in this benchmark. So they begin their paper by describing two common distribution shift settings: domain generalization and subpopulation shift, also shown graphically at the bottom of this set of paragraphs. So as said in the paper, the domain generalization setting, the training and test distributions are coming from data that are related but different. So this is, say, the domain generalization case is, say, you're doing the hospital classification, and now all of a sudden, or you're doing treatment control in one hospital, and all of a sudden now you're in a different hospital. This slight change of the underlying distribution can cause the model to fail when you're deploying it in this new hospital. Subpopulation shift refers to, say, you've built a cat versus dog classifier, the canonical example to explain these kinds of image classification problems. And all of a sudden, you've trained your model on a diverse set of dogs, and now you're only classifying, say, golden retrievers. This is the idea of subpopulation shift. The model is shifting into this really specific case of the more general class that it was trained on. So then they describe several other approaches like colored MNIST, ImageNetC, Waterbirds, and then all these other approaches like the Breeds dataset is something that I've looked at before, where people have tried to explore this idea of aggregating a dataset to account for distribution shifts. So I expect a lot of really interesting work to come out of this, a really cool benchmark, Wilds. One of the biggest criticisms of deep neural networks is that they can't learn to reason. And therefore we have this neurosymbolic AI path that they try to separate out the deep learning distributed representations with some kind of symbolic reasoning algorithm that would enable this kind of reasoning idea. In this paper, object-based attention for spatio-temporal reasoning, outperforming neurosymbolic models with flexible distributed architectures, these researchers from DeepMind show that a deep neural network-only architecture is capable of performing these reasoning tasks. So an example of these reasoning tasks is, say, the Clever-er dataset following the original Clever dataset. This is a dataset of the original dataset is a dataset of these three-dimensional objects, and you have to say things like, you have to answer queries like, which is the ball to the left of the yellow cube? Things like this that require you to reason about the orientation in space of the objects. In this case, it's even more challenging because it's a video, and video is extremely high-dimensional data for deep learning systems, because not only do you have the height by width by depth, RGB, of the frames, but then you have, say, 30 frames per second. So computationally, it blows up when you're dealing with video data compared to just static images. But in this paper, what they're doing is they're showing that an end-to-end architecture that simultaneously takes in this representation, does self-supervised learning, and then answers these questions can perform this task. So another key to making this work is the use of unsupervised object segmentation. So similar to a paper from the last weekly update, Casting Your Model, where they look at unsupervised object segmentation in order to guide better views for contrastive learning, they're using the segmentation in order to do better crops to do this position encoding for visual transformers. So the current approach to visual transformers, like the Google paper, is they basically just slice up the image into 16 by 16 grids. But this paper is showing that it's better to slice up the image into separate token encodings for the transformer by guiding it with the unsupervised object segmentation. Robert Lang has published a really great survey on meta policy gradients. This is an approach to the outer inner loop meta learning optimization problem. So in this framework, our inner loop will refer to something like fitting a supervised classifier on the CIFAR-10 labels, having an agent learn to control the bipedal walking agent in, say, OpenAI Gym, or say just any of these learning problems like having an agent that plays Snake or any kind of thing. The outer loop is about critiquing the learning process of the inner loop. And this can range on several scales. So at the most shallow scale, we could just be tuning these black box hyperparameters like the learning rate, the momentum, the strength of the dropout, the number of layers, the number of filters in the layers, this kind of surface level black box optimization outer loop idea. But we can also go more into that and do things like neural architecture search with reinforced learning, where we use the reinforced learning framework of making a set of sequential decisions, backpropagating through time, using the reward signal and policy gradients to treat this as a reinforced learning problem. Particularly the reinforced learning framework is where we have the state action, we make a prediction, we have a state, we make an action that takes us to the next state, and then after a series of these state action transitions, we end up with a sparse reward. In this case, our sparse reward is the performance of our inner loop optimization agent. So in this survey, it'll take you through several different approaches to looking at this outer inner loop optimization, this idea of second order policy gradients, and how we can look at our theta primes and our trajectories that we sample in order to do this idea of having a meta learning, reinforced and learning problem that does things like designs architectures, learns optimizers themselves, or say differentiable data augmentation. One of the most interesting research directions for reinforced and learning is the offline reinforced learning setting. This is different from online reinforced learning in that the experience has been collected from another agent, not the agent that's learning its policy. So the agent doesn't go out and fail in the world and collect experience to learn from its own failures. Rather, it's learning from the demonstrations of another agent. So this is probably best explained in the healthcare application. We can't have a reinforced learning doctor that's just deployed and starts making terrible decisions in order to learn. It needs to be able to leverage the doctor's decisions that have been done in the past and then bootstrap its own intelligence from this kind of representation. So this paper from researchers at DeepMind is presenting this problem of reward learning for offline reinforced learning. So we have this data set of experience, and it's not densely labeled with respect to rewards. It's not clear to us exactly what the intention of our agent was, what kind of reward they were seeking. All we have is this set of state action mappings, and we have to try to guess what they were trying to do. So this paper is about trying to see how we can annotate data and then propagate the little bit of annotated data to bootstrap our representation learning for the offline reinforced learning setting. The Stanford AI Lab blog has published a model-based approach towards identifying the brain's learning algorithms. In this case, they're not referring to the same model-based ideas in the previous talk on model-based reinforced learning. Model-based reinforced learning describes this framework where we have an agent that sends an action into the environment and receives a next state reward transition, but is trying to get a better sense of its environment by not only learning this mapping from state to action, but also building up a model of these transitions from state action to next state reward, and then it can use that model to plan or to maybe even train itself in some of these crazy loops. In this sense, in this blog post from the Stanford AI Lab blog, they're saying a model-based approach in the sense of exploring different ideas like supervised learning, self-supervised learning, building deep neural network models in order to test different learning rules. So in neuroscience, they don't think something like backpropagation happens in real biological brains because it requires a perfect symmetry of going forward and backwards, which they, in the tools of the measurement tools they have, and throughout this blog post, they talk about the need for better measurement tools in neuroscience and how they believe that these computational deep learning frameworks can be useful because they don't have a lot of good ways of testing their hypotheses about what kind of learning rules might be happening in the brain. So particularly the theory they have is this heavy learning idea where it's about having a local change to the weights rather than some kind of global change as in the backpropagation idea. So it's a really interesting intersection talking about, it reminds me of following some of the work that Jonathan Frankel's been doing on things like the early phase of neural network training, where they look at like the weights and these really fine grained changes in the neural network, trying to look at the weights, the connections, and have this really interesting sense of what learning rule is happening as these networks try these different tests. Data augmentation refers to finding transformations that we can make to our existing data set such that we have a larger data set that has more of this encoded prior knowledge in it, such that it stops overfitting and it enables better generalization. In this paper from researchers at Google, UC Berkeley, and Cornell, they look at this idea of copy and pasting for instance segmentation. So in instance segmentation, we've perfectly outlined these objects that we're interested in, like the giraffe, the ostrich, and the soccer players. So in this copy-paste data augmentation technique, we're cropping these objects and pasting them together to create new scenes that we can train our pixel labeling instance classifier to label these new augmented examples and thus train itself on more data. So this is a great example of how in data augmentation, when we do this cut and paste augmentation strategy, we can blow up the size of our data set in a massive way. Even in this image right here, you see the example of just cropping it compared to putting this ostrich in the middle of the soccer field. Google's AI lab is warning about privacy considerations in large language models, particularly looking at data leaking. So I'd read an old post about this from UC Berkeley's blog as far ago as August 13, 2019, which I guess in the deep learning world feels like a while ago, where they talk about doing this seeding where you could say our next meeting will be at, and then the language model will tell you where the meeting will be, and then you found them because the language model has memorized this kind of personal information in the data set. So you can imagine all sorts of things like clinical notes, or say, you know, it's trained on this personal, any kind of personal data, obviously. So what they're showing in this paper is they're looking more into this idea of training data extraction attacks. So that's probably the new name. We previously, the biggest attacks were these adversarial attacks where we looked at adding a noise map and then causing a misclassification, and that was the big attack. And now we're looking at these training data extraction attacks. So they're showing the GPT-2 paper that they can use. The way the algorithm works is that they're relying on how when the model is fitting the training data, as a result, these deep neural networks end up being overly confident on the data they've seen. So they'll have high confidence scores. And if you do some kind of, say, like a beam search, tree search within the space of these high confidence predictions, you'll be able to reconstruct the training data and, you know, reveal this information. So it's a warning about kind of the safety and trying to come up with, say, differentiable privacy as a way of avoiding this problem with language models. A generalization of transformer networks to graphs is about getting away from the line graph structure of the transformers used in natural language processing to apply this kind of architecture to irregular graphs like, say, molecules or these social network graphs, or, you know, most of these graph neural network problems aren't connected as a regular graph, or as they describe in this paper, a line graph, where in natural language processing, we take our sequence and then the transformer is going to treat it like every word is connected to every other word, and then the attention weighting is about learning the edges between these words in the regular graph in the, you know, in the graph setting. So this paper is about using things like the Laplacian embeddings. It's constructing a new way of the graph transformer layer that would help this generalize to irregular graphs like molecules or social networks. A previously trending post in Reddit was how do companies like Hugging Face or Rasa, how are they going to make money and sustain their business model, or what is their business model? So Hugging Face has recently released a $9 a month contributor supporter package. So this is in addition to their other services that they provide at the lab and startup level, enterprise level. So I think it's really interesting to just have a look at kind of the strategy that Hugging Face has. Hugging Face, again, if you're unfamiliar with it, they train these transformer models. They have this amazing library of this modular components of tokenizer, the base model like the GPT-2, BERT, and then a head on top of the model, like say you want to do classification, regression, or like extractive question answering. So they have this really great modular library. They have these open source model weights, and it's overall just a really exciting company, and they're doing a lot of cool things with respect to making content, and their research papers they publish are really great as well. So anyways, I just thought this was interesting to look at this new supporter tier that they've released, and kind of thinking about this, you know, I think it's really interesting to think about generally these companies that offer like deep learning APIs, like you would run model inference and pay for a subscription to model inference. Everyone's favorite website for looking at deep learning benchmarks or papers that have released their code has now also started a newsletter. So let's look at the first edition of the Papers with Code newsletter, which is really awesome, and I'll definitely be checking this out every week. So they are starting off the newsletter, and I'm not sure if this is like the consistent structure they're going to stick to every week, but it looks like they're starting off by saying the most recent papers with code that have been added. In this case, you see that they've added the deformable debtor, this end-to-end object detection with transformers. They've added this to the Papers with Code, and they're showing you how popular it's been. It's like an update on the new papers that have been implemented and posted on Papers with Code. So then they go into community implementations, really cool. People from the community that implement these papers, that's really cool, not just the authors releasing the code. Then also some other things, new state-of-the-art in ImageNet, these different miscellaneous things that are being done in the community. and then an announcement on NeurIPS 2020, Papers of the Code. It is run by Elvis at Papers of the Code, who previously did Dare.ai. So it has a similar structure to those newsletters that were really awesome, the NLP newsletter. So really great, and I'm really excited to see how this develops. Another really exciting AI Weekly news to conclude on is Apple has released their HyperSim, a photorealistic synthetic dataset for holistic indoor scene understanding dataset. So Apple, obviously they're doing incredible computer vision research, and this is a dataset that they're working with. So they're showing you this dataset of 77,400 images of 461 indoor scenes. So just based off what I'm seeing in A, these are probably super high resolution images is what it appears to be. And it also looks like they have these depth maps, per pixel labeling, ground truth geometry, all these different things that come with this data set. So it's a really interesting data set, and it's cool to see this open source contribution from Apple.